Hello, everyone, and welcome to Valiant Summit 2017. Yeah, love it. My name is Hunter Gorinson. I'm the Vice President of Marketing and Communications at Valiant Entertainment. We have a massive lineup of news to share with you today. But before we begin, let me introduce the guests, my colleagues at Valiant, who are joining us to kick things off. The far end of the couch, Mr. Warren Simons, Valiant Editor-in-Chief. And Valiant Chief Creative Officer and CEO, Mr. Dinesh Shamdasani.
Can we boo Warren?
Boo!
What will be a ladder if we boo Dinesh? Can we boo Dinesh?
Boo!
There you go.
Don't worry, we got plenty of cheering coming up, guys. Before we begin, let's give a big thanks to our hosts here today at Hyper RPG. We're broadcasting live from their studios in beautiful Los Angeles, California. Big thanks to Mr. Zach Eubank and the Hyper RPG crew for helping make this happen. Let's have a big round of applause for Hyper RPG. So, Dinesh, this is our third annual Valiant Summit. This has become something of a tradition for us. It's a big deal. We take what happens here today very, very seriously. We've been working diligently behind the scenes with our staff and creators to line up some pretty big, amazing news for today. What is Valiant Summit? Why is this such an important event for Valiant?
Well, I'm very excited. Valiant Summit 2017 is an important one. Valiant Summit is where we talk directly to the audience, to the retailers, to the whole world globally, and we like to tell everyone what's coming up in the next year. We work very, very far out ahead, which is something most publishers do not do. And we like to get everyone as excited as they can be, as far out as we can get them excited. So this year, we're going to be talking about 2017, all the books that we have coming out this year. We're going to be announcing a lot of stuff, teasing a lot of stuff, showing you a lot of great art. We've got some great creators here who are going to be talking to you guys about the books.
Yep.
That's absolutely what Valiant Summit is.
So if there's one word that I think sums up what we're up to this year, it's icons. And we actually released a teaser a few weeks ago highlighting some of our most popular characters with a beautiful piece of art by Felipe Massafara. What is Icons, and how does this inform our approach to publishing in 2017 versus last year?
Well, Icons is as much like Valiant Summit 2017, it is about the evolution of Valiant. We're a publisher that started in 2012. We were the best new publisher in the business that year, won Publisher of the Year from Diamond. We're a little train that keeps on chugging, that takes its shots at the big guys. And Icons is about that, exactly that. Last year, we expanded what Valiant was. We created a lot of new characters, Britannia, Savage. We did Divinity 2 and 3, made that a key figure in the Valiant universe. Elevated Faith, she's now one of the most popular characters in comics. And Valiant 2017 is about bringing back the big icons, X-Men Manowar, Bloodshot, Ninjak, Faith, Shadow Man, all the big characters coming back. We're going to put all the toys back on the table, because we had to take a few of them off last year to build the new characters.
So first and foremost, among the Icons lineup is a little character we like to call Exo Manowar. We have any Exo Manowar fans in the house? Yeah. So Exo had a big, auspicious launch just a couple weeks ago. On March 22nd, we dropped a new number one for the character, written by Matt Kindt, art by Tomas Giorello. An absolutely phenomenal book, got great reviews, sold out almost instantaneously. But there's also something very special about this.
Yes.
And that would be that as of today, Exo Manowar is officially the best-selling independent comic book of 2017. This issue has sold more than 90,000 copies. That differs a bit from what some folks have found out publicly. Can you tell us a little bit about what this kind of milestone represents for the company and how we came to 90,000?
Sure. So Matt Kindt and Tomas Giorello, incredible creative team, covers by Luis LaRosa and Kenneth Walker Ford, Miko Soyan, a bunch of great covers on this book. We've had a tremendous response. Thank you, everyone who came out and supported this book, all the fans, all the retailers. We've heard a tremendous sellout reports from the retailers, tremendous reorders as well. We also built a brand new program, the pre-order edition, which is an edition that fans had to pre-order the first arc, first three issues, up front with issue one. And they got 8 pages of new content in each of the issues behind the scenes material. So what happened is the official number that was released on the monthly ranking system was 60,000. It did not include the pre-order edition, all the reorders, etc. And we've had such strong sell-through that the reorders came in very, very strong. And our official number now, to date, as of today, is over 90,000 copies.
So the highest selling single issue from an independent publisher in 2017, which is, you know, some pretty good company to keep. And a big milestone for the company, I might add, too. So big congratulations to Matt and Tomas for making that happen. But we're rapidly coming up on Exo Manowar number 2. It's going to be out on April 26th in comic shops everywhere. And joining us here at Valiant Summit, our first guest, Mr. Matt Kindt. Let's welcome him to the stage.
Woo!
How's it going?
Welcome.
Good to see you.
Welcome, pal.
So, Exo Manowar, obviously one of the signature characters of the Valiant universe, leading off the Icons lineup for us. What made Exo the next character that you want to tackle? You've obviously played with Ninjak, Rai. The list goes on and on. Why Exo next?
Since I got my hands on Ninjak, Exo was the only one left that I really was dying to get a hold of, you know. I've been a fan of him since the 90s, you know, and I just think the concept of the character is really fun. But I think Rob was doing such a good job on the 50 plus issues he did. I was like, well, okay, that's fine, you know, and he did a great job. And I think initially I was a little bit intimidated by that run, you know. I was like, I don't know, what do you do with a character after that? I guess the idea I came up with was to do, just take him off Earth, throw him on an alien planet and see what happens, you know, and sort of strip him back down to like his basic barbarian phase, you know, take the armor away and sort of just figure out what he is as a human being first, you know, before sort of introducing the armor back into the equation. But I think that's what I like. I'm a big fan of barbarians. You know? So just getting him back to barbarian mode was the thing that I was most excited about. But also just building a world, like going to an alien planet and sort of fleshing that out and making it real and doing something that wasn't just like him flying through space and land on a planet and do his mission and then come back home, but to actually spend some time developing Planet Gorin.
Sure. Great name.
And I know, isn't it? Like, I don't know where the ideas come from, but
I don't
know. But I really want, that was the other part of it that I was excited to do, was to sort of develop an alien planet that felt real, you know, that felt lived in and had a history to it. So there's, you know, three different distinct races of beings that live on the planet. They all have their own histories and their own way of interacting. So getting to just have that existing when we meet Eric, you know, it's been some time since Rob's run.
Right.
I don't think we put an exact date on it, but it's been a while. And so we see him. We don't really know what's happened on Earth or why he's here. We sort of just throw him on this planet and have him sort of deal with this alien culture. But I think seeing that character in an alien planet, you know, and sort of out of his comfort zone, I think gives us it's a different contrast, you know, rather than having him being a man out of place on Earth in our modern times, throwing him into an alien world and seeing him react to that helps us relate to him in a way where we're kind of with him then, you know. It's like the stuff that he's seeing that's alien to him is also alien to us, you know. And I think you kind of lose sight of that fact of his character, like when he's on Earth in 21st century, that's weird, you know. It's weird for him, you know, because he hadn't seen his cell phone and that, this or that. So getting to put him on an alien planet where we can feel what he feels and everything is as alien to us as readers as it is to him, I think helps get into his character a little more.
Interestingly enough, it's something that's never been done with the character before. In his 25-year history, it feels like we've told a bunch of stories with this character from a variety of amazing creators, but you're the first one to really plant him on a whole new world. And, you know, similarly unique to that is the fact that you guys have built a massive plan for this character. It's not just one arc, it's not just two arcs. You guys are working on 5 arcs of the first year of this book simultaneously. How did that plan come together, and what are we going to see Arik do over the course of the coming year?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's weird. Writing comics is odd to me because it's a weird process because you, like, it can be unending. Like, what's the last issue? We don't know what it is, you know? So it's odd as a writer to approach a book like this and sort of have unlimited space to tell it, you know? So that's a challenge, but it's also the fun of it. So I think when we came up with the idea, it was just like, oh, let's throw them in any planet, have all these cultures do this thing, and but then we have all this space that we have room to build, you know. And so I think what I was excited about doing was then showing progress, you know. The beauty of comics and that big canvas is that you can show a character, start here, and then grow, you know. And I think that's what, kind of what we're doing is having him, throwing me on the planet. He's just a farmer when we see him, you know, and he gets, sort of gets looped back into this war that he doesn't want to fight in, but he's recruited. So he's a foot soldier for the first arc. And then every arc is sort of structured in a way we're gonna see him progress, you know, because he's a born fighter, so it's not, he's not gonna be a foot soldier forever. So he does that, proves himself, you know, he kind of gets upgraded to captain, and then, without spoiling too much, I think the titles spoil it in a way, where it's captain and general, and then we're gonna get to emperor, maybe. Yeah. But then sort of see how does a person progress from a guy on a farm to emperor, you know, and then what does he have to do to get there? How does it change him? What does he have by doing the stuff that it takes to get to emperor? Yep. And then is he fit to be emperor by the time he gets there, by having done the things he's done, you know? And I think only in comics or like any sort of long form, like if you're doing like a series of prose books, could you do a story like that where you just have a character evolve over time like that? And show him go from foot soldier to emperor. But it's also, to me, in comics, it's hard to do because you've got a character that's like Exo. He's the flagship character, you know, he's the one everybody loves the most. But to be able to do that, to show an evolution of a character that exists like that, for a company like Valiant, you know, and get him to have him be able to change, you know, like he's going to be different in issue 12 than where he started in issue 1, and sure. I think that's kind of unique in comics as well.
I mean, to that point, you're building an entirely new world, literally from the ground up for Exo. You've totally changed what his status quo is going to be, and we've talked a lot up front about how he's going to rise from soldier to general to emperor over the course of that first year. We haven't, although we announced the creative teams for the back end of the year and into early 2018, we haven't detailed too much of what you have in store there. And I do think there's some really exciting shakeups coming for the character and the kind of antagonist he's going to be facing. So we do have a little information to share about what's going to be coming up in Exo Manowar number 10, which is one of the standalones, the standalone in between Emperor and an arc we're calling Visigoth. That's going to begin in January of 2018. So who are the bounty hunters? Who are these characters and what do they portend for Exo Manowar's future?
Oh, it's bad news. No, I've loved bounty hunters since I was 7 years old, you know, and watching Empire Strikes Back. So bounty hunters are the coolest.
What you're saying is the bar is Empire Strikes Back.
I'm trying to beat Empire. I'm trying to beat it. I'm spending the rest of my life. Like for Eric to get to Emperor, he's gonna have to do some things that aren't super popular with some of the planet, you know. And I think it's up to the reader in a lot of ways to decide, you know, did he do the right thing, did he not? But I think these bounty hunters are after Eric because they think he did not do the right thing.
And I'm super excited. I can't wait for you to see to inhabit these designs that Kenneth Rockford has built, because these are some of the coolest looking bounty hunters I've ever seen.
Yeah, no, it's great. And
One of the amazing things about the course of the 15, 20 issues that we have set up right now is that we open with Tomas Giorello, and the art there has just been absolutely amazing. Matt gave him just an incredible gauntlet to draw on the first issue, where we're literally doing, I think as you described it, the invasion of Normandy, but vertically. And then after that, Dougie Braithwaite's coming on board for the general arc, and his stuff has just been fantastic.
Yeah, we just saw some pages.
The pages are amazing. And then after that, Clayton Crane, probably one of the best digital painters in the industry, is coming on board for the third arc, so we've just got tons and tons of firepower. And then to top it all off, we have, you know, Miko Soyan comes on board. We've got covers, and we've got these amazing designs by Kenneth Rockford, and then Ryan Bodenheim's going to be here. So we have just this massive year of incredible artists really inhabiting this, you know, amazing year-long story you've built, man.
No, it's great. I mean, it's, you guys pick the best, give me the best artists, the books are going to be good. So.
And just one more thing I note about the bounty hunters is, if you take a look at these designs, these guys don't really seem to match some of the other races that we know might be inhabiting the planet Gorin. So we know that you're already building that world from the ground up in Exo Manowar. You've dabbled in the cosmic side of the Valiant universe a little bit with Divinity. Is that something that you want to explore more over the coming year for Valiant?
Yeah, I mean, there's, in the first issue, we there's something in there. There's like a little Easter egg that is going to be a big deal later, like in a year, I guess. But I think we put seeds in there. They're going to grow into a bigger idea that we had from the beginning. Cool. And these sort of tie into that. But it's background now. And then, again, that's what I love about comics. And being able to plan like a year and a half out, is that you can put things in issue number one that...
like you did.
Yeah. And then, and like 16 issues later, they you can go back and look at it and be like, oh my God, that thing was in there.
What was in there?
Well, you just gave me, you just gave me the look thing. Like I've said too much.
Did I? Am I saying too much?
No, no, I think I've said too much.
No, it's but it's
perfect amount.
But I love what I love about that as a writer. I love that then it's proof that we knew what we were doing from the beginning.
Yes.
You know, it's like we didn't just make it up as we went along. There was something in the first issue that proves that we at least think we know what we're doing.
I don't know. What do you guys think? You want to see some more cosmic books from Matt Kindt, Valiant? What do you think?
Yeah.
So all the way from an alien world back to ancient Rome, I think a great indication of the kind of stories that Valiant can tell is Britannia. And this book was a huge hit for us last year. We're coming back with a sequel in April. It's going to be out on April 26th, the same day as X-Men War number 2.
For X-Men War Wednesday.
For X-Men War Wednesday. For Britannia, We Who Are About to Die number 1. Dinesh, I know this is one of your favorite titles that we've been publishing. You put a lot of passion into this. What is Britannia?
Well, Warren, Peter Milligan, and Juan Jose Rip worked their... their butts off on this book. It's a beautiful book. I'm very, very fond of it because it represents the evolution of Valiant. Again, as we talked about, 2016 was new characters. Britannia is something that we never would have been able to do, or Valiant never would have been able to do, if we hadn't built up from 2012 to get to this place. It's the story of the world's first detective. A legionnaire in ancient Rome is given the codex by the Vestal Virgins, the most powerful woman in the ancient world, and it explains to this guy, Antonius, that people do things because of their psychology, because of what happened to them or the way that they think, as opposed to the gods and destiny and fate. And he becomes the, he's one half step ahead of everyone else in terms of the evolution of psychology, of thinking and philosophy. So he becomes the world's first detective, and he is assigned to Britannia to figure out these pagan monsters that have been plaguing the Roman troops. And he doesn't believe in them, and he goes over there, and things get a little hairy, and he may have to call into question his current beliefs.
And that was the first series, which was a huge hit for us last year. Went through 10 printings across the entire miniseries, which is a big achievement.
Yes, and won a ton of awards, sold a ton. And so we're right back with Britannia, Those Who Are About to Die. And we put the same team back again on the book, and we've introduced a brand new character. She's an awesome gladiator, female gladiator. And that scene that I keep talking about is my favorite scene. You should talk to them about it. Where we introduce her?
Oh, well, she's you know, Peter and Juan just put together this amazing tapestry where they've built up Rome. As Dinesh noted, you know, there's one of my favorite scenes is Antonius is walking around and he's just looking for clues, and everyone at this time thinks that the gods are, if you see a body, you don't look at it for exit wounds. You know, we do that now. There are a million shows on TV where we look at stuff like that. Antonius does it. Everyone else thinks they're desecrating a body. So it's just the psychology that he builds up into this world is fascinating. And we meet this gladiatrix, and we discover her, and she's in the arena for the first time, and we just see what an absolute force of nature she is.
One on five.
Yeah, she takes on a whole bunch of male gladiators. For whatever reason, and we'll discover this in the story, Rome, the elite of Rome, are trying to kill her, and they're doing their best to do so. And for whatever reason, they can't get to her. So they just throw wave after wave at her, and she's just an absolute force. And
she's got a great helmet. We don't know if she's male or female yet. She takes it off.
Yep, and the
great
crowd
moment.
Just freaks out. It's awesome.
Yeah, so this is an all-new mystery, completely standalone. You can pick up this one or pick up the previous volume of Britannia. Great jumping on point for the character, and something that's completely different than any other kind of comic being published out there today, and one that, you know, we've seen a huge, huge response to. So look for more Britannia going forward, absolutely. Which brings us to some of our most demanded characters. That would be Ninjak and Shadow Man, who are coming together this May in Rapture, written by none other than Matt Kindt, with art by Keifu. We've described this as Lord of the Rings for the Valiant Universe. It's a standalone event that's going to feature Ninjak and Shadow Man, along with Tama the Geomancer and Punk Mambo, teaming up to go into the Dead Side for a quest to stop some pretty bad dudes who are trying to breach the lines between worlds. Warren, Matt, I know you guys are neck deep in this as we speak. What do we have to look forward to
just
in Rapture?
Just in case Empire Strikes Back wasn't a high enough bar.
Yeah, no, also Lord of the Rings. Yeah, you're the one that sets the bars for me.
Well, you keep hitting them, bro. Yeah.
I don't know what you want me to say about this. Yeah. So yeah, it's big. And here's the thing is, I love Lord of the Rings, but
sneeze-inducing.
I didn't really realize how great Lord of the Rings was till I read the Silmarillion, which is, and I totally said that wrong. Silmarillion. It's really hard to say, but it's like the book, the source book for all the Lord of the Rings mythology that Tolkien wrote, which is all the backstory of everything that, like the elves and all the races and all everything about them, you know, and all this mythology that he built. And to me, that's more impressive than Lord of the Rings, like, because it's like that world was real again,
sure.
You know, and it's the same thing we're doing with XO, with this as well. I always felt like the dead side, and just as an idea in all of fiction or whatever, the idea of like this afterlife or the other world or like another world, it never seems real to me. So one of my goals in doing this book was to make the dead side seem real. And I think we kind of did that with Ninjak too, where Ninjak and Shadow Man sort of, we've seen them before in the dead side, and I really wanted to make that seem concrete, like a real place that you could go and not want to ever come back to that place because it's so terrible. But I think that was one of the goals with this too, is not just have like a big epic battle with all these crazy factions and things that are happening in there, but also make it seem like a real place where these characters exist, and it's been around forever, and there's a reason and there's a sense to it, you know, rather than just magic or something that doesn't, you're just throwing it out there.
Yeah, one of my favorite things about this is we open with Tom with the Geomancer, and she's on this Indiana Jones-esque adventure, and she stumbles across a new character that we've created called Rex the Razor. We have some beautiful art here by Kafu. He's just absolutely killing it. And we encounter this character named Babel. And Tama then is forced to sort of gather up a bunch of ragtag individuals to come back and really stop Babel from ultimately, you know, breaching the live side, which is another concept that you know, you've created here. And we've got, you know, Punk Mambo. We've got Ninjak. We've got Shadow Man.
We've got
Shadow Man. I mean, you know, and one of the great things about your run on Ninjak is that we were able to build so much of Shadow Man there, where in Ninjak 10 to 13, Operation Deadside, we turned Shadow Man into the Magpie, and now we've naturally seen the evolution of Shadow Man, where he's going in this incarnation of Rapture, so it's pretty awesome.
It's almost like we have a plan for Shadow Man, and Rapture is a very important piece of it.
Yes.
It's almost like if you like Shadow Man, you should definitely read Rapture first.
It's almost as if you like Shadow Man, definitely do not miss this book. It's very important.
You think Shadow Man might be important to the Valiant Universe over the coming year? Anything else to look forward to? No?
I don't think so. Nah. Anyone a Shadow Man fan here? Disappointing. You're going to be very disappointed.
Very disappointed, yeah. And just one more thing to note on this book. I mean, you've assembled a pretty interesting collection of characters here that don't all particularly fall into the Shadow Man mythology or the Ninjak mythology. Tama, Punk Mambo, Ninjak, Shadow Man. What made those the four characters that you wanted to be the driving force behind this book?
Apart from a writer's standpoint, the fact that none of them really get along is why I wanted them together. You know, I think Ninjak is very literal-minded, and he wants answers for everything. And then throwing him in the dead side just on his own is kind of funny, because nothing makes sense to him. But then having Shadow Man and then Punk Mambo, who they're blowing magic dust around, and while Ninjak's putting a mask on so he doesn't have to breathe it, those are fun interactions for me to have. And then Tama was always a character that Jeff Lemire and I brought her into the universe in The Valiant, and that was somebody we always wanted to come back to or do something with, you know, so I definitely wanted to make her a part of this too, or make people kind of fall in love with her and want to see more of her as well. So that's why we start the first 8 pages. It's just her running around the dead side, owning
it's awesome.
It, you know.
I want to see more of just that. I want to see a whole book of just Tama doing that.
Yeah, she's like the supernatural Nancy Drew, you know. And I really wanted to bring her to life. And then Shadow Man, I think he is a character that has had a pretty checkered past. And I think that's what this is about in a lot of ways, is like trying to redeem him, or is he redeemable, you know, and him sort of going on that path. And that was the other thing. To me, the dead side, when we started this, I was like, oh, the dead side, I want to make that seem real. And then we were kicking ideas back and forth. And I think in the pitch, I was like, well, if there's a dead side, where's the live side? Like, why? We always see the dark stuff. You know, we were sending emails back and forth trying to find the worst Hieronymus Bosch images we could find. Like, let's put something like this in there or that in there, you know? And I was like, what about, where's the live side? Where's the good? Isn't there a good place you can go?
Yeah.
You know, why do we have to go to the dead side all the time? So I think that's part of this that ties into Shadow Man is, you know, he keeps getting jammed back into the dead side. And I think he wants to know that. It's like, is this all there is? You know?
Awesome.
So you're saying if Nancy Drew and Indiana Jones merge into one character and they start in Lord of the Rings, if you've always wanted to see that, or if you're upset that there's no Shadow Man ongoing ever again, you should jump into Rapture.
Yes.
That's what you're saying.
Yeah.
Good call. Good call.
Just want to make sure.
So Matt's going to be back to join us in a little bit, but let's have a big round of applause for Matt and for Rapture.
Yeah.
Which brings us to June. I think one title that we have been very excited about at Valiant is Secret Weapons. As you can see on the screen here, this is the first solo starring tale for Livewire, who's going to be coming together with a brand new team of characters for the Valiant universe. So before we dive into this one, let's bring writer Eric Heisserer out. Come on.
How you doing, Eric?
How you doing, man?
I'm cozy. This is comfy. I like these pillows.
So Eric, you have it's not every day that an Oscar-nominated screenwriter steps into the world of comics to come create something new at a company like Valiant. You know, you wrote Arrival, you've been very successful in feature film world. What made Livewire and by extension the team of Secret Weapons that you're creating, you know, what you wanted to be your next project?
Well, honestly, where do you go after you get Oscar nominated? You go to Valiant.
I mean, yes. Sure. Yeah. That's going on the front of the book now.
You know, this stemmed from the fact that I'd been working for the past year or so on the Harbinger and Bloodshot adaptations. And particularly with Harbinger, I kept coming up with ideas for Livewire. And quite often, the people around me know what I've fallen in love with before I do. And I kept coming to Dinesh, well, what about we do this with her? And he's like, dude, it's the Harbinger film, you know, it's not the Livewire film. And I'm like, yeah, but she should have her own book. And they're like, yes, are you pitching us something? I'm like, yes, I am, I'm pitching something.
Awesome.
And that's how I found my way to this, to Secret Weapons.
So what is the setup of this book? Obviously, we begin with Livewire and the ruins of the Harbinger Foundation to a certain extent, but it gets much bigger from there. So what's our way into this series?
Well, this focuses on a group of kids that are basically rejects from Harbinger's program of like his surgical procedure to activate latents, you know, and make them psiots. We see how sometimes that goes horribly wrong, and the psiot or the people in the surgical room are killed from that experience. And then you see the egg breakers, you see the awesome, you know, psiots that go on to be part of Harada's team. But you don't see, since it's a lottery system, you don't see the ones that emerge from that. But then Harada deems them kind of mundane or useless or clumsy or whatnot, and it would take too much for him to train them. So he puts them in a facility it's like the Island of Misfit Toys, but for psiots. And poor Amanda, like Livewire, didn't know about any of this until everything went sideways after the mass exodus of Harada. And she steps in to discover that now that this information is public, all these abandoned misfits are being hunted down and killed one by one. And it's doubly tragic for Amanda, who has such empathy for these kids and wants to find them and protect them.
Very cool. And you've created, really, you call them the Island of Misfits Toys, but you've created characters that have very, very specific powers that may not be the kind of stuff that you're used to seeing in superhero comics. Certainly not that useful if you're trying to go out and punch a supervillain in the face.
Right.
You have Nikki, who can talk to birds, and then this gentleman here, Owen, who has perhaps what may be my favorite power.
Oh, that's great. Punch.
Yeah.
Yeah, Owen, he can conjure inanimate objects. He doesn't know where they come from. And that sounds like an awesome power, except he really doesn't control what he gets. And that much to his dismay. And so that's been a bit of a problem for him. And we delve into his mythology a little bit more in issue two. You find out a little bit more about his powers, as he does. And then I have another character I introduce in a later issue who's able to turn his skin and anything he's wearing into like a super hard stone-like surface. But as soon as he does that, he can't move. and then the Phosphine Martin, he can make things glow. Again, these seem like basic kind of like the rejects pile, right. But then when you bring in Livewire, someone who's sort of a natural leader and has a ton of empathy, she starts to figure out for them how they can work together as an actual team and kick some serious ass.
And Dinesh and Warren, I know this is a series that we have been working on intensively behind the scenes and that you guys have been looking forward to a lot. You know, what was it about bringing Eric into Valiant that seemed like a natural fit and someplace we wanted to go next?
Eric, as he mentioned, wrote the Harbinger script for the film with us and Sony, Bloodshot as well, and he's done such an amazing job. I'm so excited for everyone to see those things come to fruition and see all the big characterizations, the big plot turns that Eric's built for you guys.
And gun hands.
In Secret Weapons. But actually, what we've talked a lot about this, what we're very excited about for Secret Weapons is it's not what you expect. It is a thoroughly character-centric story. It is heartbreaking and moving. And it's not like anything else that's out in comics. Very infrequent for comics to do a story like this. And I think that people are going to really, really fall in love with Livewire and really fall in love with the characters. And despite all the big pyrotechnics, that's what I think people are going to respond to the most. And Eric is uniquely qualified to do that.
Yeah, one of
everyone that you know that's in comics.
Yeah, one of my favorite characters is Nikki, who could talk to birds, which doesn't seem like an awesome power, but down the road we'll see that it is. And Owen, who's the Sire, who Eric mentioned, can conjure everything. I think you guys are going to love him. If it wasn't for bad luck, Owen would have no luck at all. And you meet these guys, and you know, Eric did such a great job with the script. The characterization is so strong, you feel like you've known them for years, and that's really a rare thing in comics. And as Dinesh mentioned, I don't think it's going to be what you're expecting. It's a really beautiful, character-driven story. I'm pretty excited for where we're headed.
And that's why Raul is the perfect artist for this.
Yes. I mean,
Raul Allen, who did Wrath of the Eternal Warrior, has done a ton of covers for us. This guy's a superstar in the making. I think this book is going to put him on the map in a huge way.
Yeah, I don't always do this, but whenever pages come in, I'll text Eric and I'll be like, check your email. Or I'll just send Eric an email with the pages and he'll write back and I'll be like, dude.
That's his back and forth. Dude.
So that page right there on the right is a great illustration of, you know, Raoul's talent for storytelling, which is a transition from day to night in a way that you don't usually see done in the comic book medium. Guy's absolutely next level in what he's doing on this book.
Yeah, Raoul and Patricia Martin, who's Raoul's collaborator, they're both doing this. And I think Eric and I probably spent 5 minutes walking through that particular page last week. We were just, why did he light those windows? You know, just back and forth over them. Awesome stuff.
And so we talked a little bit in the opening about how in 2016 Faith was really a character that broke out in the Valiant universe in 2016, and I think that we had, you know, do you think that Livewire is possibly positioned to be doing the same thing over the coming year in Secret Weapons? What do you think?
Totally, absolutely. Yeah. Livewire has been it's one of the most complicated characters in all of comics, not just Valiant. It's been one of all of our favorite characters inside Valiant, which is exactly what we felt about Faith, and we had no idea Faith was going to explode. And so I think all the right ingredients are there for that to happen.
Key member of the Harbinger Foundation, Robert's lieutenant.
No character in comics like her.
Leader of Unity.
Yep. Gunhands.
Gunhands. Finally Gunhands, guys. Gunhands.
And it's not just Livewire, it's not just the Secret Weapons. You're also bringing back a classic Valiant villain here in the form of Rexo, who I know we're keeping a little bit under our hats. He's shrouded in mystery to a degree, but what's your take on Rexo and how are we going to meet him in the first issue?
Well, he's like semi-canonical in that, you know, I touch on the last time we'd even seen Rexo before, and there's a new plan for him. There's a new program that had been put in place to utilize whatever they'd figured out on how to resurrect Rexo, and that deals with a competitor's technology. So that's about as much as I can say.
Awesome. So Secret Weapons issue number 1 is going to be out in June. We're also doing something very special to coincide with this, a program that we launched back with Exo Manowar number 1 through 3. Dinesh, what is the Secret Weapons pre-order edition?
Sure.
And how can you get it?
Much like Exo Manowar, it's a new program that we created, and it was a way for us to help you guys make sure you get the books, because we know that our books sell out very quickly. It's a way for us to help the retailers get as much information ahead of time so that they're not caught off guard by the huge demand. So what it is we build these pre-order editions. Each of them have 8 pages of exclusive behind-the-scenes content, so interviews with Eric, behind-the-scenes material from Raul and Patricia, etc. And the only way to get them is to pre-order all 4 issues before issue 1 hits a certain date, the initial order date for retails, which is for...
April 27th for Secret Weapons number 1.
So you've got a little bit of time left, and you get all of them, and they're the exact same price as the regular edition, you just have to get them up front.
Yep, with a whole bunch of bonus content that cannot be found anywhere else. So it's a special thank you for the fans for their big show of support and coming out and pre-ordering the books, which is, without a doubt, one of the most valuable things you can do as a fan. So yeah, Secret Weapons number 1 coming out in June. Let's have a big round of applause for Mr. Eric Heisserer. Yeah. So from Livewire to one of the other leading ladies of the Valiant universe, none other than Faith. Do we have any Faith fans in the house? Woo! Joining us today here at Valiant Summit 2017, let's welcome Jody Houser to the stage. So 2016 was a huge year for Faith. You did a ton of exciting work with the character. We went from a limited series that defied everyone's expectations, I think, to an ongoing series. It was one of the biggest debuts of Valiant for the year. Tons of great reviews, tons of press for the character. You know, what is your approach to Faith? Where did you start with this character before any of that big stuff happened? What was your way in with the character?
Well, I remember Warren asked me to take a look at Harbinger and see if there were any characters that really stood out to me as someone I would want to write, you know, a miniseries for, and Faith was really the standout character, I think, in the book, which Joshua Dysart, who wrote the original run on Harbingers when the company relaunched, he said that himself. She's like the breath of fresh air, and among everyone else who's really sort of sad and, you know, in agony over having these powers, and she's like, guys, we're superheroes. This is the best thing ever. And just as someone who also grew up, you know, reading comics and watching sci-fi, that was a character I just immediately latched onto because she's the one who actually gets to go out and do the thing we all dreamed about as a kid. Like, she gets to save the world, and she's someone who is optimistic enough to believe she can do that and she can make a difference. And just the fact that she's being informed by all of the same things that we would be informed with if we were heroes in the real world. It's just been so much fun working with a character like that and putting her optimism to the test, I guess. And just see, you know, if she wants to be a superhero, let's throw everything a superhero would have to deal with at her and see how she handles it.
And you've done that to a great degree in the pages of Faith's solo book. You've created a whole new status quo for the character outside of the pages of Harbinger. She lives right here in Los Angeles. She's a reporter by day, superhero by night. She's starting to get her own rogues gallery.
Oh yeah, and that was
currently with the Faithless.
Yeah. Yeah, that was a big deal for me, was because I feel like the best superheroes are really defined by their villains to a large extent. So I wanted to have a really cool rogues gallery for her. And then in the current arc that's going on right now, the Faithless, we brought all the villains together for the first time, which is an interesting experience for her.
Yeah. So all of your work with Faith over the past year is really coming to a head in the pages of her solo title, building up to issue 12. But where we go after there is going to be someplace, I think, even bigger than anything that's been done with the character before, for a project that we're calling Faith and the Future Force. As you can see, Faith is about to get mixed up not just with the Harbinger kids, not just with Unity, but with the greatest heroes of the Valiant universe, past, present, and future. Guys, Jody's going to be working with Steven Segovia, Barry Kitson on this book. What is Faith in the Future Force? Why was Faith the right character to lead a big summer event for Valiant?
Well, something in this I've been seeding back since the miniseries, it's clear that the one thing Faith would really, really love to do is travel through time. You know, she's a Doctor Who fan, she's dropping references to that all the time. So now she actually gets to do that, but not for a fun jaunt through history. It's essentially to keep time from unraveling.
Are you saying that Neela Time Walker is back?
Neela Time Walker is back. Oh, you changed the picture, but she was right there in the corner, yes.
Yep. She plays a How do we get to the Future Force? Obviously, we need Neela Time Walker to make that happen. Why Faith? Why now? Why is Faith the person who can save the future?
That's an interesting question, and that's something Neela, as someone who is who's essentially the new Time Walker now, she has information that Faith may be the only one who can save history. But how or why she got that—that's a little bit of a spoiler.
Cool.
But yeah, I mean, it's she knows that Faith is the hero who might be able to keep the entire reality from disintegrating.
Awesome.
But that's kind of a hard thing to do on your own, which is sort of where everyone else comes in.
So the stakes like really couldn't be higher for this book. This is easily the biggest story that Faith has ever found herself at the center in, and this is the first time that we're really pulling together all of the timelines of the Valiant universe, which is, you know, a big deal. It's something that has not happened to date anywhere in the company's line. Warren, Dinesh, what made this the kind of story that we wanted to tell with Faith going forward, and who can we expect to see in the pages of this book?
Well, I don't know how spoilery we want to get, but
just a touch.
The narrative structure that Jody came up with is pretty awesome, and it helps explain why we have sort of multiple artists coming on board. But as we progress through the story, Faith is going to see that she needs more and more firepower to help take out this malevolent AI that Jody's built, and it spans all different timelines, it spans the future, it spans the past.
When you've got a time walker, you can get all the firepower.
Everything. Very few limitations. So, you know, Jody's put together a pretty awesome story here. And that's just a touch spoilery, bro.
If at first you don't succeed, try again.
But we have a pretty cool lineup of artists coming on to this book too. So issue number one is going to both have Steven Segovia and Barry Kitson, two totally amazing artists with long distinguished runs in superhero comics. Are we going to see more of that going forward? How does the artistic duties on this book going to work?
Yeah, it's a very precise split. You know, Jody's built a narrative that we have very specific reasons for why different artists are going to be here. We've got Steven Segovia joining us for the first issue. Steven's a fantastic artist. He just did a beautiful job for us on Matt's Ninjak. And then we have Barry Kitson, who's one of the great illustrators, just a fantastic talent. He's done some amazing work for us on Harbinger before. He'll be coming in for part of issue one and issue two. And we have Clayton Henry coming up behind the scenes after that. And we've got a couple of other people that we're eyeballing for.
Yeah, rest assured, we're being very coy here, but rest assured, this is a book that we've put a lot of time and effort into. There's a huge cast here. Warren and I were talking about how we thought, Jody, that this is the best thing you've ever written, frankly.
Oh, well, thank you.
The first issue. And so there'll be more details coming up, but for right now, rest assured, there's going to be a big story. You're going to have a lot of fun with it, and there's a ton of great artists on this book.
It really is. I mean, when we say it's an event, this really is an event in the truest sense of the word. This is bringing together all of the biggest guns of the Valiant universe. I was comparing this to, you know, like our Infinity Gauntlet or something. This is where all the characters get together for a big universe-ending battle royale. Like we've never seen before.
And the thing that I love so much about it is when we get there, ultimately, you'll see is that Jody's put her own spin on it. So it's not just another punch-up where we're going to take something out and defeat it, and then we're victorious and we head home. The way that we're going to close this thing out is a truly Valiant thing, and it's very, very much to your sensibilities. Yeah,
but there's also a lot of punching.
Tons of punching.
Cool.
Tons of punching.
And I also just really love the design. Who did the design for the villain AI?
Clayton Henry.
Yes, I love how it doesn't actually look that threatening. But yes, but yes, all of reality is at stake from that thing with a little grumpy face.
As it should be. What do you guys think? You guys pumped for Faith in the Future Force?
Thank you,
Jody. Cool. So we have a big summer coming up. Faith in the Future Force is going to kick off in July, but that's not all. Coming in August, we have something so secret that we can't even tell you about it today. Dinesh, why is August classified for the Valiant Universe? Can you say anything about this?
Clearly, the book is named Classified. I'm very excited for Classified number one. Yeah. No, we cannot say anything. This is we're going to tell you a lot about what's coming in 2017, but we got to keep a little bit still close to the vest. Classified, you're going to have to wait and see what we got coming up.
I don't know, is it a fan favorite character? Is it a giant icon for the Valiant Universe? What could it be? Warren?
It's pretty exciting, it's pretty remarkable, but it's classified. So we're gonna need to get back to it.
Good deal. But one character I think that anyone who calls themselves a Valiant fan certainly has an affinity for. If there's one, it's gotta be Bloodshot. Jeff Lemire has done some amazing work on this character in the pages of Bloodshot Reborn, and he has a new series coming up beginning in September that we're calling
Reborn. Bloodshot Reborn.
Bloodshot Salvation.
Bloodshot Salvation.
That's right. Warren, what is Bloodshot Salvation? And what's
he was all about Reborn over and over again. We got to do it.
Really tried to sell us on Reborn. What's Bloodshot Salvation, and who's teaming with Jeff for this book?
Well, Jeff did a masterful job on Bloodshot Reborn, which was just, we saw him rebuild Ray Garrison as a character. And really sort of put Jeff's spin on it. Jeff's one of the finest writers working in the medium now. Incredibly talented guy, and he teamed up with Miko Soyan, Luis DeRosa, a bunch of some of the most remarkable artists in the Valiant stable. And we opened with Ray in a motel room, and he'd essentially given up being Bloodshot. And we sort of went through this journey where he'd gone from being essentially a weapon of a paramilitary group known as Project Rising Spirit and being sort of sent on these bloodthirsty missions to discovering who he was and trying to build a life for himself. And in Bloodshot Salvation, Jeff's taken that to the natural conclusion, or the natural, I should say, evolution, where we introduce a new character called Jessie, who's Bloodshot's daughter. And what we're going to see is the relationship that begins with Bloodshot and Jessie and Magic, and sort of see what kind of a father Ray is. He's a really good one. And Jeff, who's written some of my favorite things over the past decade, including Essex County, Our Run on Bloodshot, Underwater Welder, just a masterful writer of characterization, has really put a beautiful spin on it.
So Jeff has given Bloodshot a family?
Yes.
Jeff Lemire gave Bloodshot a family?
Yes.
You don't think he's going to take it away?
He wouldn't do that.
Is he going to do bad things to
his family? It depends what page comes up next, I'll let you know. So what we discover, we see that Ray, we open one of the issues with basically the daughter going through, being put through the gauntlet. There we are, where Jessie is attacked by four guys in baklavas, and Magic helps fight them off. And she's crying and she's saying, "Why'd this happen, Mommy? Why'd this happen?" And Magic looks at her and he goes, "Because Daddy couldn't leave good enough alone." And she's like, "Where's Daddy?" He goes, "Daddy ain't coming back." So that's where we start the series, and we have this beautiful dual narrative, which is drawn by both Miko Soyan and Luis LaRosa.
Luis in the present, Miko in the future, so two timelines at once.
And yeah, hell of a team.
Yeah, so we've got an extraordinary team coming up. Brian Rerun Color is doing a beautiful job here. And it's really just, it's you know, one of my favorite issues month in, month out. You know, Jeff's a master plotter. He's done a wonderful job. And Luis and Miko's pages, they come in, I send them around. The guys just shoot back emails, "Wow, this is stunning." So we're pretty pumped for it.
Well, the scripts, I mean, this is an emotional roller coaster. So Bloodshot has got a family, then he's not there, you're not sure why, he's got to go somewhere, or he's done something that's caused his family harm. We see Jessie when she's a young girl and she's vicious. I mean, it's a roller coaster. And these guys on the art, it's going to be a monster book.
Yeah, and one of the things that Jeff's done really well is he's building up the villains in this particular arc. In the last run, we had a lot of villains and it dealt a lot with the psychology of Bloodshot and what he's gone through. But in this particular arc...
In the last one, Bloodshot was his own worst villain.
Yes, he was his own worst villain. I was talking with Jeff about this, and he's like, "Yeah, we needed some villains to get in here." So he's built together an incredible roster of villains for us, and that's Rampage there on the right. So we're pretty pumped, as drawn by Miko Soyan. So we're pretty pumped up about what's coming up.
Big classic villain, much demanded, back now in the fray, worth the wait. His first appearance is very mean.
Not a nice guy.
Well, not just Rampage, but also out of the ashes of Project Rising Spirit, we're going to get Omen and the Scarred Man. What kind of impact are they going to have on the universe at large?
Well, as we saw out of Bloodshot USA, Project Rising Spirit, when they tried to turn New York into a Bloodshot-invested zombie death pool, it did not work out that well for them. And that's where Jeff picked up in Bloodshot number 0, which is out now, where he really sees what the fallout of that was. And we introduce a new character called the Scarred Man. And we discover that he's basically going to be heading up Omen and kind of... taking the kid gloves off, as it were, to really ratchet things up, which will have a huge impact on our universe this year.
And I think one of the things worth mentioning here, and I'd love for you guys to jump in too, is, you know, much in the same way that Jeff worked super far ahead and built a huge plan for Bloodshot Reborn that spanned, you know, 2+ years, and then the way that Matt just built a year and counting of Exo Manowar, we're doing the same thing again here on Bloodshot Reborn. This is going to be another massive launch for Valiant coming up later this year. Can we tease anything about what Jeff has planned? Because he too is building a huge runway that he's taking this character down.
What I'm most excited about with Salvation is the fact that Jeff has built this 2-year story with Bloodshot, and it's such an amazing story. And you know, people want to jump into it. This is a great place to jump in. This is a brand new starting place, and he's already got a year in the works all at once. We've got tons of scripts in already. Art's being worked on for a number of books. We can't tease, and you know very well why we can't tease, but there'll be more details coming up soon, unless you want to tease, Warren, and incur the wrath of Hunter.
Well, one of my favorite things about Jeff is that you'll talk to him on a Friday, and he's spending a couple days over the weekend, you know, thinking about stuff to do, and then you'll talk to him on a Monday, and he's got a 15-issue plan of exactly what's going to happen with Bloodshot, where he's going to go, what arc 2 is, what arc 3 is, you know.
And it's genius.
And it's flawless. It's just fantastic. So he's one of the most accomplished and talented plotters I've ever seen. And he really captures that here. And all these, what's that in that middle panel? What is that on the third panel?
That's a good tease.
So that'll be a key story coming up. We've got it in the first panel as well, second panel. So Jeff, he's doing a great job here. He's really excited about it.
So these are pages from the Valiant Exo Man of War Free Comic Book Day special, which is going to be coming out in the first week of May, available at every comic shop in the country participating in Free Comic Book Day. This really is a roadmap to where Bloodshot Salvation is going to be going over the coming year. Yep. There's nothing in this story that is an accident. Jeff has really built a treasure map to where he's going to be going with the character. And by extension, we could say the same thing about the rest of the book as well. This is the Exo Manowar FCBD special, which features glimpses of pretty much everything we're telling you here today at Valiant Summit, is pretty much maybe the best jumping on point that we have for the company all year. What else is in this book, guys, that we should give a shout out to?
Well, there's a brand new Exo Manowar story that sets the ground for the Exo Manowar book that's just launched last month. There's a brand new Bloodshot story that, just like Jeff did 2 years ago in Free Comic Day, he built a brand new story that laid the seeds for a bunch of stories that will come. And so you can go in there and try and figure out what he's got coming up. And this is brand new and free.
Yep.
In May.
And plus an advanced look at an extended portion of Secret Weapons number one, a couple months before it hits
stands. Our usual teasers and a big, awesome Valiant Universe image.
Yep. Lots of teasers.
Lots of teasers.
This is a big one. This will be a big book for us.
Cool. Now we get into another very exciting project that we have coming up. So if you've been following Valiant at all over the past couple of years, you know that there's perhaps no bigger new character in the Valiant universe than Divinity. This is a series that really took on a life of its own. The story of a lost Russian cosmonaut returned to Earth with godlike powers, created by Matt Kindt and Trevor Hairsine. Something that I know we're all exceptionally proud of and very excited about. What is the significance of Divinity in the Valiant universe, guys? What do you think?
Divinity's a godlike character. He's more powerful than anyone else in the universe. He is uniquely qualified to be able to jump into stories that are on a cosmic scale. And Matt's a genius. He's built him to have the mind of a man. And so he's a reluctant godlike character. He's also communist. He's from the 60s. He's this very, very unique character. And I think that's partly why he's been so successful. This book went to 11 printings.
Yep.
Divinity 2 went to 5 or 6 printings as well. Yep. Stalin vs. Divinity 3, big sellout as well, is going on right now. We've got a few more planned.
So Stalin vs. just ended. So why don't we bring Matt Kindt back out to find out what's coming up next. Come on, Matt.
Hi. How you doing, Matt?
Good.
So why don't we set it up? Mm-hmm. We just wrapped up Divinity 3 Stalin vs. And after Divinity 3, comes something entirely new, something that we're calling Eternity. What can we say about this, guys? What is Eternity, and what is its significance for the publishing line?
It's so weird. We've been teasing this thing for 2 years now, but you can finally talk about it.
Can I? How much can I say?
Everything.
Though?
You can say.
I can
everything.
Say everything. So that I can talk about the baby.
Yeah, talk about the baby.
Right. Well, they have a baby. but that's just where the story starts. I think where we left off. Mishka and Divinity had a little, there was like a little quiet domestic scene at the end, and we sort of leave them there, and then we pick up with Eternity, and now there's a baby.
Yep. And so the fascinating thing about what we're building here and what you're putting a lot of your creative energy into is this isn't Divinity 4. This is, it uses Divinity as a jumping off point to tell an entirely new story about not even the Valiant universe, but perhaps an entirely new universe.
Yeah, that's a good point.
You're creating so much stuff here. I think it's blowing everyone away, and we'll share some of it here, but...
Who is Eternity? Who is this spectacular new character, Eternity?
I think, I don't want to say too much.
We won't say too much, but Eternity is not a, person, it's a place.
Yeah.
And if you've wondered what the unknown was, perhaps how, where, who or where or what gave Divinity its power, where all of that kind of stuff comes from, we're calling that place, perhaps, Eternity.
It has a good ring to it.
Yep.
It does.
I think if anything, we're going more cosmic than we did in the first three stories. We're just blowing it out, and you guys sort of gave me free rein to come up with something insane, which is like a whole, basically a pocket universe, which is what the unknown is, which I think for the first three arcs, and we don't really know. It's called the Unknown for a reason, because we don't know.
The thing that gave Divinity and the other cosmonauts its powers.
One of my favorite things about the story is that we, in the first issue of Divinity, we open into the 1960s, and while America's targeting the moon, the Soviet Union is targeting the edge of the galaxy. And what we discover is that they get there. And the cosmonauts encounter something which imbues them with this extraordinary power. We've kind of been teasing it for three issues, and they're really explaining what it was or how they got there. But with this particular issue, with this particular series, Matt and I were talking, we're both huge fans of Jack Kirby, the King. Yeah. And we send pages back and forth to each other.
We're not trying to beat Kirby.
No, we are not trying to beat. There is no beating Kirby. There's that's right. Very clear. There's no beating Kirby. But Matt, a couple years ago, where was it? T2E2, I think. You showed me that page that you bought of Kirby. It was like a turnaround, and we send Kirby pages back and forth to each other all the time. So we love this. We love Jack Kirby. He's the King. We're incredibly inspired by his work, and we're talking about just blowing things out into like kind of a crazy way. And this is one of those characters that's uniquely qualified to do this, I think.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard to not have Kirby as a touchstone if you were a kid growing up reading comics, and he definitely was. So bringing that, trying to figure out how to get that into a Valiant universe, which is science-based, to me was what made it fun and different. It's like, okay, Kirby's done what Kirby did, but how can we do something that captures kind of that vibe, but we do it in a way that makes sense in the Valiant universe. And there is like a science explanation for everything that is going on here. Like I did a ton of research on how a pocket universe works. Apparently that's a real thing that can be. And so I read a lot about it. I put it in the pitch I sent you guys. It's in the very bottom. Mm-hmm. I'm like, if you're curious, here's a bunch of stuff you can read.
Oh my God, but, I spent so many hours trying to understand what the hell you were talking about.
I did too. I was trying to read string theory. God, when was it? Last year. I read the same like six paragraphs
for like find YouTube
10 times in a row, and I was like, and then my mind, I can feel my mind like this. It's like, I almost get it. No, I don't
it
understand.
It turns into a singularity. Yeah, yeah. Yes, that's string theory.
So that was where I started. I was like, okay, how do we get to something cosmic and crazy, but we do it starting in the Valiant universe, which is our world, but like 10%, like tilted 10%, So it's like, how do we get there?
One of the great things about our universe is that, we don't have gods descending from the skies or, deus ex machina is all over the place. It's a very science-based universe where, it's essentially our world if it was tilted 10% in a different direction. So it's kind of fascinating. Mm-hmm. The challenge to build that with those kind of with that structure.
Yeah. So, but what you're doing here is not a small undertaking, as you guys can see from some of the artwork we're showing on the screen here. It's not a small cast. Your guys are building perhaps dozens of new characters that are going to inhabit this world. It's a whole new pantheon for the Valiant universe in a way that's never existed before. Characters that perhaps even outrank Divinity in their power scale and what they're capable of doing. How does that inform the kind of story you're trying to tell? I mean, is Divinity the waypoint through that we're going to meet this entire new world of characters?
Yeah, he is. I mean, without spoiling too much, they have a kid, and the kid disappears. So Divinity basically looks around with his cosmic powers and can't find their kid. And he's like, what the heck? And so then we follow him as he goes back to the unknown, enters this world, and then encounters all these crazy characters, which I think in the pitch there's 25 named characters, right. and then there's a whole world, and then I've sort of sketched out how the universe works and how it's structured and the roles that everybody plays, Again, it's like world building, like kind of like we did in XO, but this is like sort of
universe
a cosmic
building.
Sort of a pocket universe, which is fun. I guess that's the thing I like to do, is come up with like a world and society and a way for people to work in these weird environments.
And you're designing a lot of the characters, but we also have some other artists from across the Valiant line contributing. These are by artist Kari Evans. You can get a sense of kind of the color palette of what the world of Eternity is going to look like, which is virtually unlike anything else, that we've certainly published of a scale that's, pretty much unheard of in comics today. There's a ton of creative potential flowing through this thing. Dinesh Warren, are you particularly excited about one aspect of this book?
This is the most ambitious thing anyone's talking about in comics right now. We're literally talking about creating an entire new universe with an entirely new tone and dozens and dozens and dozens of characters. Hopefully we get there, hopefully this doesn't all crumble. And Divinity is the platform from which this all sprouts, but it's not Divinity 4. That's a very conscious choice in all our parts. Incredibly excited. And I hope we get there.
And we've got our secret weapon in Trevor Harrison returning.
Yes.
Yeah. Trev is he drew Divinity 1, Divinity 2, Divinity 3. And Eternity is a new jumping on point. It's going to be a new entry point for us as we try to do with everything at Valiant. But Trev's just such a master storyteller. One of my favorite things about working with Matt is that he'll send the script and it'll have crazy character designs. And those were just what we saw on the screen. But when the pages come in from Trev, you know, Matt and I will marvel at just his storytelling, his rendering, his ability, his execution. It's really, you know, just fantastic.
No, I think that's the thing that was great for me about Divinity was having the consistency of the whole team on it. You know, like it's kind of a weird book to begin with. Like when the first arc came out, I was like, this is not like anything you guys are doing. Like, what is anybody even going to respond to it? You know?
Yeah, and David Barron on colors just killed it as
yeah,
well.
And
Ryan.
Ryan on Ian. Yeah, honestly, we're all going to get
Ryan.
I was thinking about this yesterday. I was like, man, we've been through so much with this series. I feel like we're like, not to bring up Lord of the Rings again, but I'm like the cast of Lord of the Rings. I emailed everybody. I was like, we need to get like a Divinity tattoo because we've been through this,
yes.
whatever, like
yes. if
12 issues of Divinity.
Ryan Wynn, David Barron, and Trevor Harrison will never work with anyone else ever again. And then you're writing all those stories.
No, that's great. I think we're going to get matching tattoos.
But I'm personally very, very excited for this. Knowing what you guys did together on Divinity and now that you're coming together to build something entirely new is a fantastic proposition. And it's a little bit Kirby, it's a little bit Mobius. It's entirely different than the flavor of anything else we've attempted thus far. Super excited to see what you guys have in store. Awesome. Let's have a big round of applause for Mr. Matt Kindt.
Yeah.
See you later. Which brings us to Colin King, MI6's most dreaded intelligence agent. We have any Ninjak fans in the house?
Yeah. Woo! Yeah. Matt Kindt's trying to sneak back on camera because he's so excited to clap for Ninja.
Warren Dinesh, what's Ninjak's significance, you know, to the Valiant universe?
He's a British spy who knows a very high form of ninjutsu, and he's also a complete a-hole.
Yeah, he's a bit of a dick.
Yeah.
He's basically a mercenary for hire. He finds himself more often than not aligned on the side of good, working with MI6, a member of Unity, kind of teaming up to help stop threats that will kill all of us very frequently. But he's a bit of a jerk. He's had a pretty rough life, and he's channeled it into being Ninjak, and he's a ninja, which is awesome.
So we've, you know, successfully built Ninjak as a solo character in the Valiant universe once again over the past couple of years. But this November, we're going to be doing something very, very different with a new team at the helm.
Yes.
Why don't we welcome the new writer of Ninja K, Mr. Christos Gage, to the stage.
Hello.
Yep.
Hey, Christos.
Hey, how's it going, Dinesh?
Hey, man. How are you doing?
Good to see you.
So as longtime readers of Ninjak know, he's not MI6's only ninja.
Yes.
There are many, many throughout the ages, and you're going to be shedding some light on that. What is your take on this book that we're calling Ninja K?
Yes, well, credit where it's due. It was Matt Kindt who introduced the notion of that Ninjak is actually Ninja K, and that means that there was a Ninja A through J. It took me a minute to do the alphabet.
Ninjage.
We're going to be, you know, how is it that a practitioner of a Japanese art of espionage came to be MI6's, a British intelligence agency's top agent, and what's the history? We're going back as far, so that's how far back we go as we find out about Ninja A, Ninja B, who was the first British ninja, and then going on into throughout the years, into the 60s, the more James Bond style ones, 70s, you know, what if Foxy Brown was a ninja, is sort of my take on that one, and you know, up to the present day. But what's happening in the new storyline is someone is killing people associated with the ninja program from the past, and Ninjak has to investigate because he's probably on the list. But we're also going to be exploring what makes Ninjak himself different, which is that he's the first one that's a mercenary, that's freelance, that has some independence. But you know, I don't want to give away too much, but we're really going to get into that backstory. I thought Matt did an amazing job getting into the personal mythology of Ninjak and where his powers come from, what his history is, his childhood, And now we're going to be getting into the background of the program. So very excited about that.
Awesome. And one of the distinguishing things about this book and your first script for this thing is absolutely killer.
Thank you.
Awesome. We're building a 40
it's extra long.
Yeah,
it's 40 pages.
40 pages.
Yep.
40
including
page
the complete
issue.
History of the Ninja program from World War I to the modern day. Mm-hmm. It's awesome.
And, and if we didn't kill Thomas Giorello on EXO, we're going to do
correct.
It.
That's right.
That's really it.
I'm super excited that he's doing the first issue.
One of the fascinating things about this book is the previous series was a little bit superhero, a little bit supernatural, a little bit kung fu or martial arts. This is very much an espionage-driven take on the character. I've been calling this thing the biggest budget James Bond movie ever made. What made that the lens that you wanted to approach Ninjak through compared to what might have come before?
Well, I mean, partly because I was such a big fan of what Matt did that, you know, why retread old ground? Why, you know, Matt did such an amazing job with, you know, putting Ninjak in the dead side, which I thought was great because, as he pointed out, it's almost counter-programming. But he did it, and he did it well. Not to say we'll never do it again, but that didn't seem like the way to start out. He also got really into Ninjak's personal mythology. So the feeling was, you know, let's root this, let's lean into the whole super spy thing and make this, as you said, the biggest budget James Bond movie ever. You know, much like the James Bond films, if you haven't been reading Ninjak, you can pick up this issue. You'll get everything you need to start. Like, you can watch Skyfall without having seen Goldfinger. But if you're a hardcore fan from the start, then you know you will be seeing threads picked up and it will inform it, but we're also very new reader friendly.
Absolutely. And Warren, I know you worked with Christos previous. What made
the first issue, as you mentioned, is 40 pages, but that just barely begins to touch on where we're going. And it's really in the same vein of EXO or Ninjak or, mm-hmm. or Bloodshot, where we're really building out this huge broad tapestry almost a year in advance of where we're headed. If not more, you know, Christos sent in this pitch document which had every ninja basically, and it was just awesome. And I was talking with Dinesh, I'm like, we should just publish this dude. Yes. The first issue should be Ninja A, next issue Ninja B, but we wrapped around the story, we made the first one oversized, but I'm pretty pumped for it. And Tomas, who's just killing EXO right now, Diego Rodriguez, our color star on EXO, are gonna go over and launch this for us next. So we think it's a really amazing right hook to lead out.
Super, super excited. And Dinesh, I would just ask you one question as well, which is, you know, in terms of the Icons launches, we talked about how we put a ton of work into EXO Manowar, making sure it was a distinct entity that was informed by what came before, what was a new jumping on point. You know, what makes this a good jumping on point for Ninjak?
Well, I think first of all, I think we're all blessed at Valiant because we can build these giant mythologies out of these characters. We can tell very character-centric stories. You guys support us. We don't want to take advantage of that and just tell villain of the week stories. And so with EXO Manowar, instead of just doing more stories of him on Earth, let's send him into cosmic. Let's send him into space. Let's see what that looks like. Fulfill the potential of EXO Manowar. I think what Christos is doing here is exactly that. If you read Matt's Ninjak, it's an amazing book. It builds this whole mythology, and he teases this espionage component to it. So let's do a book where we just blow that up, and I'm sure Christos will tease another element to it that will allow Ninjak to continue to be a more three-dimensional character again and again. And so for me, I think this is a book where if you've never read Ninjak before, it's a whole new tone, a whole new point of view that is informed by what's come before, but not necessitating that you have to read what's come before.
Yep.
And hopefully get you excited enough, if you read this one, to go back as well as forward.
Awesome. That's Ninja K coming in November. Let's have a big round of applause for Christos Gage.
Thank you. I want one of those Ninjak mugs. Okay.
So the Valiant Universe has an alien armored Visigoth, nanite-powered commando, purple ninja who works for MI6, and also two adopted brothers who don't get along too well. Anyway, we have any fans of Quantum and Woody here today?
Yeah!
So this has been one of our most demanded returns, and here at Valiant Summit, we are super proud to announce that in December, Quantum and Woody are back in an all-new ongoing series written by Daniel Kibble-Smith, art by Kano, the beautiful cover by Julian Tedesco.
The crowd is literally jumping up and down. They're literally like bouncing. You can see them bouncing a little bit. They're that excited.
So why Quantum and Woody? Why now? What does Daniel have in store?
It was time to bring. We have a lot of great superheroes. They're really effective. X-Men or Save the Planet many times, Ninjak 2. It was time to bring in someone who was terrible at their job, someone that would definitely screw it up.
Didn't get along.
So that the other characters had something to do, so they had something to save the world from. And so the world's worst superhero team is back. What you want to tell us a little bit about the book, Warren?
Well, what we're going to discover is that the brothers, I just want to mention that, as you know before, we walked in here and we were able to access some of the greatest characters of all time, created by guys like Jim Shooter, Bob Layden, Barry Windsor-Smith, David Lab, and Joe Quesada, and Priest and Braid. And one of the great things about this particular run that Daniel's coming up with is we get to see the brothers in a way that we've never seen before. We're all huge fans of the issues that came before, but seeing the brothers really not in the same kind of status quo that we've really ever seen them before. They're not on speaking terms. No matter how bad it's been doing Conan and Woody over the years, they've always been brothers, and they have these bands that are attached. One is on Quantum, one is on Woody, and they have to clang them every 24 hours. So it's one of Priest's really brilliant metaphors for family, where it's sort of, you can't take them or leave them, you always gotta keep them. Mm-hmm. And Daniel's really drilled down into this, and he's built a story where we open, and the brothers are basically engaging with each other because they have to, not because they want to.
Once every 24 hours. Hi, clang, get out of my life.
And there's been a terrible falling out. And what we begin to piece back is why this has happened and what the story is about, really. Why they have a falling out. No matter what Woody, who is a ne'er-do-well, who's always been in problems, who's always been arrested, and Quantum's had to bail him out, and Quantum's the straight-laced guy, he works for a living, he cares about society. No matter what they've been through, they've never fractured this badly. So we open and we see them in this place.
But it's Eric's fault. But Eric's the one that messed up this time.
Yes, Eric did mess up this time. He messed up big time. And you don't expect it to be that way. But we've got our awesome cover up here by Kano. Kano's back. He's going to be drawing this.
For real, guys, there's no Shadow Man coming. I know you were all excited.
But Kano's back. When I asked Kano if he wanted to do this, he's like, I've been waiting to draw those two jerks forever. I'm excited again.
Did he really say that?
Yeah, he's just so happy. He couldn't pass. So he's back. He did a beautiful job for us on the Delinquents book, which is a Quantum Woody and Archer and Armstrong crossover. He's perfect for this. Daniel's come up with a great story here. If you guys are not following Daniel on Twitter, start right away. He's one of the funniest guys.
Genius.
He's an absolute genius. He writes for the Daily Show with Stephen Colbert. He's a real talent. So I think we've got something special here.
Yep, and Kano's first interior since Book of Death one shot he did. So
it's great work on Delinquents. But in keeping with what we were talking about with Ninjak, this is a book that, again, we're very blessed. We get to build a mythology of these characters out. It is a book about family, and Daniel's been very smart. He's built a story that is about family, and we get to learn a little bit about Woody's family and a bit about his origins, too. So stay tuned for that.
And just very briefly, I know we probably should address it. I know there was a leak of some Quantum and Woody television news. What can you say about that, Dinesh? Anything?
Live on the air, Dinesh asked about TV shows. Yes, we have the Russo brothers are producing with us. They're huge Quantum Woody fans. They were integral in both Modern Family and Community. Two shows that have a very specific tone, and they're bringing that to Quantum Woody. We also have Barr and Ferrari, two fantastic writers. They wrote Ant-Man and Ant-Man 2. Those are the components that have been announced so far. There are equally large components in this show that have not been announced in terms of actors and other producerial writing capacities. So stay tuned. We'll announce them when we can. But rest assured, this is going to be a big, big deal, guys.
Lots of stuff coming for Quantum and Woody later this year, and this is going to be a book that you're going to be hearing us talking a lot about as we head towards December. So that is our 2017. What do you guys think? Anything worthwhile? But we know that Valiant's a company that likes to work ahead, and I think we should maybe just tease out a little bit about what might be coming in 2018. Do we have anything we can share? What do you think?
A little something, something.
A little something, something?
Something we already announced, in fact.
We talked a little bit about an event called Harbinger Wars 2. Have you guys heard anything about this?
Yeah.
Okay, so coming in December, we have a very, very special book called Harbinger Wars 2. This was available only as a special mail-away exclusive that you could get by redeeming some coupons that were in Harbinger Renegade number 1-4. And here at Valiant Summit, we're going to tell you for the first time that book is going to be written by Matt Kindt with art by Doug Braithwaite. That's a creative team that's worked on some of our biggest titles. And they are devoting a lot of time to this special one-shot story that's essentially a thank you for the fans who put their a lot of work into getting that book from the coupons for Harbinger Renegade number 1-4. What can we expect from this book? I know it's still a little bit far away, but what do we have coming for Harbinger Wars 2, and how does this fit in?
Harbinger Wars 2 is going to be the biggest thing we do, guys. 100%, this is the biggest story, the biggest conflict. Nothing has prepared you for what we're going to do with Harbinger Wars 2. And to show you how serious we are, we're doing two things. One is Harbinger Wars 2 number 0, which is not essential reading, but anyone that's read Harbinger Renegade and wants to read Harbinger Wars 2, definitely you should try and get this book. It's going to be a fun book. And then the other thing that we're going to do is Harbinger Renegade number 5 is going to be a very, very emotional book, so much so that we have a wrap. We have a wrap, a warning label on the book.
Yep, this is one of the most hardcore things that we have probably done. There's a very, very graphic death of a major Valiant character in this issue, and we're so secret, as a matter of fact, that I think, how many people only know about it? 5 of us, myself, you, Warren,
Derek,
and Rafer.
That's it. Yep. We have not even told the rest of the Valiant crew, because it is such an inflammatory thing we're doing that we're afraid it's going to leak. We want to keep this as big a surprise as possible for you guys. Hence the warning label, hence no one at Valiant knowing other than the 5 of us. Good luck trying to get it out of us, by the way. And stay tuned for the issue, because it, again, like we talked about, Jody Houser's best work, perhaps, is going to be Faith in the Future Force, her best to date. I think Rafe Roberts' best script ever is his script for Harbinger Renegade number 5. I think the best stories from Valiant are yet to come.
Yeah, Rafer just crushed this issue. It's absolutely fantastic. And Derek strung the heck out of it, but we're pretty stoked.
And what you're going to see slowly over the course of the coming year, Harbinger Renegade number 5 comes out in July of this year. We're calling it the beginning of the road to Harbinger Wars 2, and you're slowly going to start to see the dominoes that are going to fall over the next 12 months as we lead into what, as Dinesh said, is our biggest event to date and most impactful.
From a narrative standpoint, this thing is going to be like nothing you've seen from us before.
Absolutely. So that all begins in Harbinger Renegade number 5, and then Harbinger Wars 2 number 0 will be shipping in December to the folks who are able to redeem it. And as you can see, there's a lot of folks who could potentially have a target on their back based on this image by Mark Lamming. So who's that character you mentioned before? I think I forgot. Who's the one that
the one who's definitely not getting a book?
The one who's definitely
Shadow
not
Man.
Shadow Man?
Nothing's coming from Shadow Man.
I don't know. Do we have any Shadow Man fans here? Would you guys like to know anything about Shadow Man? So I think without a doubt, Shadow Man might be our most demanded character. What do you guys think?
Yes, definitely. Definitely. Even the logo alone gets people excited.
Yep.
And so, that's all we got for you guys. Yep. Just the logo.
Just the logo.
Good night. Thanks, guys. Thanks for coming.
So we have something very special coming for Shadow Man, and we can't tell you too much about it, but we can tell you the date, and that is March 28th, 2018. There is going to be a new Shadow Man book on the stands. This is a major date for Valiant for a very special reason. Yes. Dinesh, why?
Well, listen, guys, I know what you're feeling right now. This is a long ways away. This is 1 year away, but think about it this way. X-Men Man of War, we announced that book well in advance. We put an incredible team on that book, a number of great artists, and we put all our resources towards making it a massive, massive book. Today we told you that X-Men Man of War number 1 was the biggest books, one of the biggest books of the year and the biggest independent book of 2017. And I think we're very safe to say no book will beat that record in 2017. We're gonna do the same thing with Shadow Man. We already have a fantastic pitch, a fantastic writer. We've got a great creative team. And as we march towards March of next year, we're going to be showing you a lot of really cool stuff. So it will be worth the wait, guys. But it is a little bit away.
Yep. So this is going to be a major, major date for Valiant going forward. I think we're planting our flag in the sand here. If you guys have seen the kind of work that we put into X-O Manowar this year, get ready, because March of next year is going to be massive for Shadow Man and a major publishing
event
for
us. And March is going to be a big month for us every year going forward. We've grown now to a place where we're very lucky you guys have supported us. We've been very successful. We're going to take our shot now at the big guys a little bit, just a little bit. Every March we're going to do something really, really big, a big launch, a big something. And this year was X-Men Man of War. We've got X-Men Man of War Wednesdays every month this year. Next year will be Shadow Man, and that'll be equally seismic.
And we should mention that art is by the incredibly talented Greg Smallwood, who you guys know from Dream Thief, from Moon Knight. Phenomenally talented guy, and has delivered some absolutely stunning work for Shadow Man. So very excited for what's coming in 2018. But without further ado, we have a couple minutes left. We'd love to take some questions from the audience if you guys have any. We have time for 2 or 3 questions, and we'll take some questions from the Twitch live stream. Anyone out there feeling itchy? What do you got? Question? Yes, sir.
Will the goat make a reappearance in Quantum?
Oh, I'll state it again. I'll state it again for the live stream. Will the goat be appearing in Quantum and Woody?
The goat is, I mean, how could we not? How could the goat not be in Quantum and Woody? the Guild might be more popular than not just Quantum and Woody, but every other character at Valiant. So much so that in the development, we'll talk TV show for a second, in the development of the TV show, all anyone wants to hear about, I'm talking Joe Russo, Anthony Russo, Gabe and Andrew Barn-Ferrari, all they want to do is talk about the GOAT and trying to get a GOAT button issue, a button episode where nobody talks, it's just the GOAT for 22 minutes. This is how popular the GOAT is. So yes,
that's
plenty
awesome.
Of GOAT coming
awesome.
Your way.
All right, let's take a question from the Twitch stream. Here we go. A lot of characters coming back in 2017. When will we see more Rai and 4001 AD?
Well, we've got the one shot coming up in June with Rafer. July, June.
Yep, there's Rai, July. The History of the Valiant Universe coming up this summer, and then July. Faith in the Future Force, of course, which is going to have some 40%.
History of the Valiant Universe. We're going to check in on Rai. We're going to see. That will be Rai will return there. We've got Faith in the Future Force, as Hunter mentioned.
Yeah.
And we're cooking.
If only we hadn't announced everything. Did we announce everything?
We didn't announce everything.
Oh, that's right. We've got one thing left.
Mm. You know, walking through that, it was great to see how stuff went away for 4 or 6 months, came back. You know what I'm saying? When it was right, when it was perfect.
Yes.
When the timing was right.
You know? Rather than what we're talking about, it's very important that we address this. Rather than continually publishing a book and letting the quality dip, we at Valiant want to make sure everything we do is worth the time and effort, the time and money that you guys pay to consume it, and so we like to take these breaks, make sure we have a really, really great book before we come back with it.
The only pressures on us are trying to tell great stories, and that's what we always strive for. We don't have to do...
Yes.
We don't have to do 4 line-wide crossovers every year to goose numbers for a quarter. We don't have to do anything like that. The pressure that's just on us is to make sure that Harbinger's ready to go when it's ready to go, Shadowman's ready to go when it's ready to go. So that's really, you know, that's really one of the foundational elements of Valiant.
One more question. Yes, sir.
What's the future of Archer and Armstrong?
What's the future of Archer and Armstrong, guys?
Faith in the Future Force would be a great place to check in on that. We absolutely love the run that Rafer just finished up for us with David LaFuente and Mike Norton. We're cooking. Not everything. We're not going to announce everything today.
I'm sick of them. I think they're done. That's it. Much like Shadowman, never again.
Let's take one more question from the live stream. Seriously, guys, who dies in Harbinger Renegade number 5?
All right. Okay. I can't. Sorry. I'll get really mad.
Warren is available to bribe.
Yes.
I just want to put that out to the world.
Very low bribe. Three figures we're talking here. Give you done.
But I've hired a sniper to tail Warren everywhere he goes.
You didn't tell me that.
I'm telling you now. The minute it looks like he's about to say something that's related to Harbinger Renegade 5. That's it. New EIC.
Done.
Time for one last question. We can take it from the house or from the live stream. Anyone here?
No?
All right. What's next for Savage?
Warren, Savage?
Savage being the series by B. Clay Moore,
yes.
Clayton Henry, and Louis LaRosa that we
yes,
released
one of the new characters
of
that were released last year. One of the characters that came out in the last year. We love the response to it. Louis LaRosa, obsessed with dinosaurs. If you want to get into a 45-minute conversation with Louis about the minutiae of dinosaurs, just talk to him about feathers. He loves it. It's his favorite thing to do. One of my favorite people in the whole wide world. Louis is the best. We've got some plans coming up for Savage.
Quite a cliffhanger on that last issue.
Quite the cliffhanger.
It's kind of awesome. The story's going to be awesome. I don't want to get too far into it right now, but it's awesome.
Awesome. So that's what we have for you guys today. Thank you to our wonderful audience here. Thank you to our guests. And again, another major thank you for Hyper RPG, who right here in this studio hosts the Valiant Vanquished role-playing show every Wednesday. Zach, do you want to come on out, buddy, and say
sure.
What's what?
Sure.
This is Zach Eubank, CEO of Hyper RPG, and our host today.
We get out of your way.
So no, you guys are good. You guys are good. This will be quick.
Well, you guys are going to create a singularity.
Yeah. On the same couch.
You feel
what
threatened?
If they touch.
You feel threatened,
like
time don't you? Cop,
there can be only one.
The universe can end.
We got Warren here to
keep the buffer.
So Zach, you've been tapping into a whole new, you know, angle on the Valiant universe through Valiant Vanquished. What is that show for fans out there who may not know, and how can they get involved?
Well, the show has been running for over a year now. We did this first season last year up in Seattle, and we just started our second season down here in LA. And we're really excited and proud to be a part of Valiant Digital with you guys this year, which is really cool. And I think you guys are absolutely crazy for working with us, because it's a it's a live RPG with a bunch of comedians. Here at Hyper RPG, we are super fans of the Valiant universe, and all of our hosts are big fans of the Valiant universe as well, but they're also comedians that can roll poorly. And then all of a sudden you end up with a gas can that shoots confetti and talks. And now it's a part of the Valiant universe, which is really cool. But it's a live RPG every Wednesday night at 9:30 p.m. The audience is able to interact with the show. Every week we pull a winner from the audience to be an NPC in the show, so they get immortalized on the show as well. And it's a really crazy and absolutely nuts fun time. It's really fun.
I can't stop watching. I'm not a role-playing guy, but I can't stop watching you guys just have a blast and make jokes and play in the Valiant universe.
Yeah, we're only 4 episodes in right now. You can catch up on YouTube. And actually, when we're done here in just a couple minutes, if you're watching on the live stream, we're gonna play the first 2 episodes.
Awesome.
Just let them run through the afternoon, and you can ask lots of questions in the chat. We have a lot of fans in the chat. And it's been really cool for us to bring our love of the Valiant universe to our chat room, and now have discussions about the books, and to host you guys, and to host this event, and all of you as well. This has been a really, really, really cool. Kind of a nerd dream come true.
Indeed.
In a lot of ways.
And thank you for letting us borrow the studio for
thank
you. That afternoon.
Yeah, awesome, of course, awesome of spot. Course.
Last question for you. The road to Harbinger Wars 2, we just said a little bit about that, what we're going to be doing on the publishing side. You are getting to see a little bit of the secret sauce.
Yeah.
I don't think you've been brought into the secret club of six yet.
Not all the secrets, but you know, one of the fun things that Josh and Dinesh asked us to do is to use the show to help build up to the excitement of Harbinger Wars that's coming. And so our show is a group of recently activated psyots who were released as latents on the psyot papers, and there's a lot of people who are trying to control that situation, and there's a lot of mysterious players involved, and we get to kind of work towards those big events in really fun and creative ways and hide little secrets in there for you guys.
Yeah, super cool. All right, let's have a big round of applause for Zach, our host for Hyper RPG. And that concludes this year's Valiant Summit. Thank you so much to everyone watching.
Oh, wait, we have one more thing.
Oh, go. What is it?
We have a giveaway for the audience that's watching.
Wait, there's more?
Yes, there's a giveaway. So for all the people who are watching the live stream, get active in the chat room. We are giving away a signed poster from the event, a collection of Volume 1 comics, and some exclusive merch that'll be shipped to you directly from Valiant. So Lucas, you want to go ahead and pull a winner? He's going to pull a winner and yell it. So if you want to close out, then we'll announce the winner.
Thank you to everyone that came from the live audience. Thank you also to the crew back in New York, all the guys that helped put this together, Robert Myers, Charlotte, everyone. Thank you to Shanice, Josh, Andrew, Ryan, everyone that's helped today. Big thanks to Hyper RPG, all the creators.
Still boo Warren, though, right?
Well, I didn't say thank you to Warren, did I?
Okay, good.
That was not a mistake.
Thank you guys so much. Really appreciate it. That concludes this year's Valiant Summit. Thank you guys so much for
winner. Mikasa, whatever, it's in the chat. Thank you guys. We're gonna play that playlist. Stick around.
Thank you.